Okay, hello. Thank you for coming to Women in Architecture. Before we start, I will read the antitrust statement. It is the practice of the American Institute of Architects and its members to comply strictly with all laws, including federal and state antitrust laws that apply to the AIA operations and activities. Accordingly, this meeting will be conducted in full compliance with those laws. Ta-da. All right, now we can go. Thank you.
You want to introduce our moderator first?
With that?
You want to introduce the moderator?
Yes, all right, we will do introductions now. But we should also, we should do our business real quick.
Sure.
Monica, if you don't know me, Monica Gresser. Myself and Anna Peltier from Aria Landscape Architecture are the co-chairs. We're missing our secretary, whose meeting ran late, Alexia Chin. Today we are talking about the mom circus as women in architecture. I don't know how you people do it, so since Anna, Alexia, and I, none of us have kids, we invited in Lisa Schock from Grand Canyon Development Partners to act as moderator, somebody who actually knows something about, you know, being a mom and having kids. So that makes it a little bit, if you guys have any questions, you want to talk about anything, shoot us something over in chat and we will figure out how to look at it, or Carlos will pop out of his office and tell us what that is. So today we have Lisa Conley is the only thing I think of. Amy Conley, and then Jenna Rutar. Why do you look so different to me? Is that one of you online? I know, but why do you look so different to me today? It's taken two sips and already I'm gone. And then Kelly Hemming, and then you already know Anna. And also on our panel today is Michelle Duranello. What's your name? Your head is more like condensed now. So now that we've added more people. I was introducing everyone.
Oh, okay.
And
you can totally speak
if you want. Jennifer's online. I see that. Who else is there? Jess Lay, Adriana, that's Benjamin. I can't see your whole name. I'm sorry. Melina Clark, is that what that is? I'm sorry, Melina.
Yes, that's it.
Ooh, Ashley Yeager, who just popped in? I can't read. Oh, Jess. Okay, good. Glenn Frank, Lexi Selvig, and who's the last one? Did we lose that stream? Maybe we did. So thank you all for joining us today. I know we've probably got one more at least coming, so we're stuck in traffic. So if you're on the I-15, it's no bueno. But we did not come that way. So I don't know how we got here on time. Hey, look, it's Ned in the car driving down the highway.
It's apropos to have the kids in the background. That's perfect.
There you go. So Lisa and I were talking on the way up here. We were driving in together. That it's just crazy how your schedules work. Like, I will roll out of bed, maybe brush my teeth before I go downstairs to put the dogs out, and then I feed them, and I go back upstairs, change my clothes, and I leave. So really super simple, right? Don't have to worry about having kids. Very easy. You guys all have quite a different journey than I have had. And so we want to talk about like what those journeys are. And then you've got people like Susanna who are here to tell you that you can raise some kids while you're in architecture and they won't turn out to be serial killers. So,
yes.
Well, not yet.
On my people.
Hey, about serial killers? Yeah. So there's hope for you yet. If you're worried about, not being around your kids enough or being around them too much, Susanna can, help you out there. So far, they're still lovely people. And look, she's still alive. So I'm going to let Lisa start off, and if you guys have questions, put them in the chat. We'll talk about that. You want to say anything else before we get going?
I would really like to give our panelists and moderator a round of applause because we can.
Oh, because we can. Thank you all for showing up.
Yes, thank you for being with us today.
Yes, thank you so much for that. It was kind of a big deal. It's our first time back in person. You can talk as long as you want until I kick you at this table. Or I'll tap you ever so.
All right. Well, good afternoon, everyone. This is Lisa Shaw. Thank you, Monica, for the introduction. And thank you all for inviting me to join this forum. It's actually incredible how I'm actually free to be here. It's all about juggling. So currently I have a 4-year-old and a 6-year-old. 6-year-old's a daughter, 4-year-old's a son. And all I can say is there's a lot of prioritization in regards to juggling kids and work. Especially if you have a spouse or no spouse, you really have to juggle what your priorities are. And just a little bit of a background, my husband used to be a chef at several hotels at a restaurant, so he used to work swing shift when our kids were born. So basically, I still worked during the day, then after work I hustled to pick up our babies from daycare and then play mommy duties until they go to bed. So that's been a struggle with opposite schedules, but now that he has a day schedule as a culinary instructor, some of the duties now are relieved, being that my children are a lot older than their infant stage, thus less having to pay more attention in terms of bottle feeding and diaper changing. So it's all about prioritization. Some things just have to give. I mean, my whole mantra is the kids come first in terms of their happiness, consistency, health-wise, and just to ensure that they're safe and sound and they feel secure. Because infants and toddlers growing up into older kids, they thrive on what their upbringing has become. So I would think that structure and routine is very important from the day that they're born up until, I don't know, they decide to move out. So before kids, I used to be a gym rat. I used to go out with my friends. I used to go to dinner with Monica, you know, talk stories. But now all that has just gone away. And it's not because, I don't love my friends, but it's just that.
She doesn't.
I left you hanging. It's just that there are now more pressing things to take care of, rather than the entertainment and going out and all that. So that definitely forces you to really switch your routine. And really, being that I'm more of a structured planner, you also have to make room for things that don't go according to plan. What is your contingency? What is your backup? Or how do you address certain situation at a given moment? You're in the middle of a meeting, you get that phone call from daycare, my kid's sick, now what? Luckily, my supervisors have been totally supportive in regards to I have to dig out from the meeting, can you carry this for me? Because it's all about the culture in the workplace. And now that being older, when I go and interview for a job, my last job interview, my question to the interviewer was, how flexible are you in regards to schedule with employees with children? And to me, a supervisor that is understanding in that regard is a big plus for me. I mean, I'd rather take a $20,000 pay cut to have a supervisor or a company in support of that, because at the end of the day, if your child's sick, you have to go. Work will be there the next day, but you have to go. So my typical regimen, I get up at 5:30, I get myself ready first, takes about a half hour. Then I get my kids up. At this point, they're independent in terms of getting themselves dressed, brush their teeth. While they're doing that, I'm downstairs making my coffee, preparing their breakfast, letting the dog out.
Good for you. 4 and 6, and they're getting themselves dressed.
That's excellent.
Because I forced them. No. Either that or mama yelling, right? So by the time they're done, I'm done with letting the dogs out, feeding the dogs, the breakfast is ready on the table. They come down, eat their breakfast. While they eat their breakfast, I pack up their lunch, I pack up my stuff, load everything into the car. Once they're finished eating, they put their shoes on, and then they're ready to go. So it's a lot of zoom, zoom, and it's a lot of sequential events. Kind of like a project, right? While your plans are in plans check, there are other things you need to do in the interim, so but when this task is done, your permit's ready for construction. So it's a lot of sequencing, credit or what you can squeeze in during this time. You know, it's, and fortunately, my children are pleasant. They haven't thrown anything yet. They have a really bad tantrum. If I asked them to do something, they would do it. I just explained to them at a very young age that mom and daddy works a lot, and we are all in a group, and to explain that scheduling routine and try to be on time, you know, from everything that you do, really helps them grasp the concept of schedule, routine. Yes, they have to get up and brush their teeth. Yes, there is no goofing off during this time. So to me, that worked. But I understand that every parent is different. Every child's different, so at the end of the day, you have to do what's best for your family.
So let's get Michelle to introduce herself. Michelle's an architect over at Knit.
Yep. Hi, Michelle Duranlo, architect at Knit. I have a 10-year-old and a lovely partner that is very understanding with the schedules that must be maintained. I moved out here in Vegas in 2007, and I got laid off basically in 2009, which a lot of people did. And for me, that was when, or for us rather, we really started our family planning, because I was like, all right, well, I'll have the kid and, you know, we'll get this ball rolling, and since I have the time to do the whole, you know, infancy stage, you know, and that was probably the most intense, you know, probably 3 years of my life, really giving that focus and time to an infant to toddler stage. And Lisa's absolutely right. Once they gain independence, it's so much better. they start, you know, finding their own routine. Well, not finding their own. They embrace the routine that we give him. and what is really nice is my wife and I, we both pursued our architecture licensure at the same exact time. And our son was very understanding. He understood that there was a lot of time that we had to dedicate to work, and then when we got home, it was study time, you know. And I don't think that there are a lot of kids out there that will understand that at a young age. So he was around 5, 6 years old when we did that, and he was just so cool. If he was any other kid, I think we would have had to do it separately. And then once we got our license, Dawn is a contractor, not contract, she works for a contractor, she's an estimator, and I am an architect with Knit. So both of us, we deal with a lot of different deadlines, right? So I think that for us, especially since our son is 10, like I said, he's very much on his autopilot, you know, school routine, wake up, get to, you know, all of that stuff. It's very much him now. But for us, we, you know, we have to work out our schedules, because each one of us has different sets of deadlines, right? So when the crunch time comes for her, then I have to be more lenient on my side to fill in, you know, the gap, and then vice versa. When she's facing a deadline, I have, you know, it's just the opposite. And I think that it's worked out. And Lisa, I think that you bring up an incredible point, that you need to find a place that is understanding of family, and that there are certain requirements that, or it's not requirements, but like there's just certain things. Yeah, if the kid gets sick, that's it. I'm done. I'm out. I gotta go. You know, and my office is very understanding. You know, I could work at home anytime I want. You know, especially with you know, the quarantining and everything else. I think that that's a silver lining to the quarantine, right? I think everybody's understood that, you know, the work can be done at home. So that's nice. But yeah, I mean, we worked it out. It's hectic sometimes. And, you know, there's a lot of town board meetings that I got to skip out of dinner and stuff like that. And we work it out. So, but that's kind of my story.
Thanks, Michelle.
Yeah, no problem.
Amy?
What about you?
Where are you?
We're doing an overview here.
We're doing an overview.
All right. So I'm Amy Fincham Conley. I own a high-end custom home design firm, Tilt 23 Studios. I've had had all kinds of different, you know, I guess it's looked very different throughout different stages of my life as a mother. So I went through, you know, 9 years working in an architecture firm, as well as going to school full time with a 1 and 2 year old when I started architecture school, and had a husband that I divorced after 7 years with that. So then I was a single mom for 10 years with 3 kids. And at that time, I decided the best route as a single mom in architecture was to have my own businesses, so that I was able to bring kids to the office and juggle a little bit better. And then in the last couple years, I've had a spouse to raise kids with me, and now I have a 20-year-old and a 19-year-old who are on their own. My 20-year-old's making me a grandma and getting married Saturday, so that's kind of crazy town. And I have a 13-year-old. So I guess it's been kind of a journey of, like, different situations as being a mom. Got very quickly to a point where you realize there's no such thing as, like, really pulling everything off, so you give up stuff. So stopped caring so much about the house, and the priority became time with the kids. And don't care who has a problem with my messy house. You know, I pulled it off, you know, in the early years because I had a really supportive employer, Chris Larson, if you guys know mm-hmm. him. He is an angel to work for. You know him, right? Mm-hmm. And that's really key, right? I mean, that's been said a couple times, like going to work for people that are going to support you as a woman in this industry. I think you see so little women in our industry because the balance of being a mother and working in this very demanding field is really challenging. So having that support, or I'm a real big, you know, encourager of start your own business, because then you don't have to beg for a seat at the table. You can just create your own table if that's an option. And I think probably one of the, you know, there's been a lot of lessons, right, trying to juggle everything. There's times where I felt like it was necessary to really be at the office late and kind of make sacrifice with the children. But I would say after raising 2 children, I maybe would have rethought that. And so now I have a 13-year-old, and I know better this time around with teenagers. And I had a babysitter say this, you know, as a single mom, it was like, I was like, I feel really bad because my little kids are not getting enough of me. And she's like, well, you know what, give yourself a break when they're teenagers. That's when you want to be there. And I could now, looking back and remembering her say that, I couldn't agree more. Because I feel like when my teenagers were falling off the cliff and spiraling, the one savior is time with them. So I have found that to be like the magic potion for getting your kids back on track as teenagers, is they just want your time. They just want your time. And so that would be my big takeaway as a mom is you're never going to get that time back with your kids when they're at home, right? That's a short period of our lives. It doesn't end at 18. It really gets tougher once they hit 18, in my experience. But it's a short period of time where moms and you know, there's probably some things I would have done differently to give them more time, but I just kind of feel like sometimes we have to, like, just be working harder as women to get at the same, you know, playing level. So that'd be my little overview.
Thank you, Susanna.
It's your turn.
Yeah, so I graduated architecture in 85. I moved back to Vegas. I spent some here. Moved back to Vegas in 90 and worked for a developer for about 4 years. Always wanted to have children, but it was sort of getting to, I was getting to an age where it was like, either I have them now or I'm never going to have them. So at 31, I had my daughter. That was in 94. And what a better time to start, go on your own, because I still had the idea that you could do everything at home while the kid is there. Well, about, I don't know, 6 months into it, I found out that a babysitter is a must. If you don't want to work till 4 o'clock in the morning and they go to meetings during the day, and, you know, they always want to eat at the wrong time. So she went off to the babysitter about 3 years later. By then, I already had my own farm. I had my son. And had him on a Friday. He came to the office on Monday with me. So I did do good with some submittal, planned submittals, because I always had a baby in the carrier, and all those women are always, so they all knew me right away. And, you know, my son was probably in the office with me for about 5 weeks before I begged my babysitter to take him early. And so they both turned out okay. We still had family vacations. Even now, I try not to do more than 40-hour weeks. I don't expect my employees to do 40-hour week, more than 40-hour weeks. I figure it's not like we deal with life and death, like the surgeons, where we have to be there. First thing you notice as you go through this is that, you know, it's an emergency on their side, and it comes to payment, and all of a sudden it's not an emergency, or even picking up the plans when they're done. Not an emergency anymore, as long as it's done. So, you know, your own time became more important than some of the jobs. And now at my age right now, I don't have the kids at home. One's 27 in Colorado. The other one's 24 on the submarine somewhere right now. I have no clue where. He graduated the Naval Academy. But he's a junior officer, probably doing all kinds of stupid things to prove something from a senior officer like that. So they're doing good. I'm back now in the office, back to 12-hour days. Well, I had my break while I had my kids, I guess.
What happened to that 40 hours?
They went away, because it was either that or come home and start drinking sooner. So the whole celebration, and I only have a couple hours of that. Like I said, I was 31 with my daughter, almost 36 with my son. Neither one of them are in a hurry, looks like it. So hopefully it'll be another 5 or 6 years before I'm a grandma, even though I'll be looking like one. So like I said, it's been a good journey. I would not have done it this way. I've always thought I was going to do my own firm. There was never any doubt that I was not going to. We got him into swimming. They were both swimmers, so there was a lot of juggling in the afternoon. I have been, but like everybody said, with my own firm, I remember being in meetings, and all of a sudden my cell phone rings, and it's school. Now, I forgot my daughter a lot more than my son. And she's the first one. She was training. And it's the principal going, okay, we have your daughter. You haven't picked her up yet. But, excuse me, I'll be back in 10 minutes. And I'm the door I went to throw into. So I think most of the clients were pretty understanding. I think most of them are. Even the contractors and all that. I think they all have kids at some point. I remember with my son, she was a month early. I was working on a house. I think that was when Evan still worked with me. Working on a house, or maybe, anyway, I'm off to here. They all know I'm going to have that baby any moment. So this one lady that I was doing the house for, she's like, she called me up on a Monday. She goes, well, you know, we really need to wrap this up. This house up because, you know, you're going to have this baby and it's going to be, you know, then I'm never going to get my house. I said, well, you know what? Michael's already here with me. So, and then after about a week, it was like, okay, so how are the plans going? I was like, I can't get anything done. Mm-hmm. You know, he's crying every half an hour. He wants to be fed. And then nothing was getting done. So she took the next 2 weeks, came in for 2 hours a day and babysat her. To get her house.
My goodness.
No fees required on my side and no deductions on her fees.
Make it work.
It did work. Like I said, they've grown up. Now I'm just looking towards retirement, I guess. As soon as possible.
Stop it. You keep saying.
Thank you. But yeah, so. Like I said, I've had several employees. I've never had a problem with them. I've had several over 27 years of business, but never had a problem with them taking off when they have to for the kids. So I think everybody in this room knows what, you know, you just have to go when you have to go. So that's my story.
Thanks, Tim. Okay, Kelly, what you got? Because you are non-traditional.
Yes. So my story is a little bit different than everybody else's. I am a only parent, and I got into this as an only parent. I adopted my son by myself. So I knew that I was going to be making changes career-wise. Pretty much ahead of time. I wasn't quite planning it exactly how it happened, but I adopted my son in 2009, and that's when everything started falling apart. And when I got the call for my son, I was working for a general contractor on City Center, and I basically asked my boss, hey, I just got a phone call to, you know, for a baby, and, you know, how much longer am I really going to have a job? And he said, well, he goes, don't not take, you know, take this baby because this is what you've been waiting for. He goes, but you probably have about another 6 weeks. So, so I said, okay. And I said, I'm taking Friday off. I'm going to go get him. And I had my mom come in, and she basically stayed with my son for the first 6 weeks. And then I had about 6 months, about five, really, until I got a call saying, hey, I have a job for you, but don't know if you're going to want to take it. And having had some friends that were already out of work for over a year and quite some time, I'm like, whatever it is, I will do it. So I ended up packing up my entire house, getting it rented out, and I moved to a town in New Mexico I had never heard of before with my son. And and for the next 4 years, we moved all over New Mexico, Texas, Arizona, and Southern California for the company that I worked for. So it was quite interesting having to, you know, we moved every 6 to 4, I think 9 months is the longest we were in any location. So it was constantly finding doctors and daycare and schools and preschools and everything else. And we worked a lot of Saturdays, so obviously those resources are not open for you. And I did have some guys that I traveled with on my team that that their wife came, so they would help out every now and then. But my son was with me on job sites in his stroller from the time he was an infant. And I was really lucky that my team, because we moved together, we were very family oriented. They really embraced him. So whenever we would have like team barbecues, he was always there. He was on the job site. It's really always been just the two of us. And when he started to get back into, or when he was at the age where he was going to start kindergarten, I really wanted him to be settled. Back up a little bit before that. When we were in California, I was commuting about an hour and a half each way for work. And so for me, I made the decision to put him in daycare, and it was preschool at that time. Put him in preschool that was right down the street from work, because I didn't want to waste 3 hours of my day away from him, plus my hours of work. So I put him in daycare there, and he basically commuted with me to and from work every day. So we had that time together. And then when he was getting into to kindergarten, I really wanted to have him be settled. So unlike you, our life has never had any order, any anything. I mean, we never knew where we were moving, when we were moving. We were supposed to be in Albuquerque for 2 weeks, and it ended up 2.5 months. And living in a hotel because we were only supposed to be there for 2 weeks. So our life has been chaos, and I'm an order person. And I ended up calling up some friends, and I moved back here working for a general contractor, and that didn't necessarily work out for several different reasons, nothing to do with motherhood or childcare or anything like that. And that's when I decided that for me, working so many hours and dragging him around to work events and everything else, being on the general contractor side, that's when I decided to take a step back from my career and move into the manufacturer rep side. That gave me a lot of flexibility in my time, where I could go to school and see his school plays and see his school events. And that was just a little bit more important to me. Like you said, they're only little for so long. And I didn't want to waste that time. So starting a business of my own really has never appealed to me. I admire those of you who do it. But it was just never something that appealed to me. So that's why I got on the manufacturing rep side, because it does give me a lot of flexibility. My son is extremely active in sports, so it is a constant juggle. He's 12 years old, and it is a constant juggle. He travels, he's on a travel team, and he has, sometimes we're juggling 2 or 3 teams that he's on because they need him as a guest player. So, we are always chaos. I never know what my week is going to look like. I can have it perfectly planned out, and it doesn't end up that way. So both of us have really had to learn how to roll with it. And it doesn't always work because of my personality. And it works completely well for him because I always say about my son, he will never die of a heart attack. He may get hit by a bus, but he will never die of a heart attack because he's so chill. So while I don't recommend traveling and doing the life like I did to anybody. It's very stressful. It has made him able to make friends very easy everywhere he goes. He has no problem doing that. So, you know, I think my advice as a mom is you have to kind of just do your life as you do it and know you're going to make 100 mistakes and be completely okay with it. But I look back on all the travel that we did, and it is some of our greatest memories were doing that. So, yes, my life is a little unconventional. There is no order to our life, but it's ours, and we try to make the best of it.
Thanks, Kayla. It's all yours.
That's the way. I already have like 5 questions. But you go ahead.
Okay, so so as a mom, did you ever feel that at some point you were a failure?
Many points.
Like you're the ultimate failure. You, whatever you did, wasn't right, and then, I don't know, you just feel like your whole world just kind of fall apart.
What have I done? Spending so much time away? Yeah, I've had some stuff. What have I really done? I mean, they're fine.
Yeah.
I have 2 kids. I have 2 sons. They're 12 and 20. It helps to space them out, I'll tell you that. But
17.
Yeah. That's a little far, but yeah. It, you know, that helps. But, yeah, I've had thoughts. You know, like you guys, I work full time. Monica, I was just going over my teaching hours for yoga, so I teach yoga as well. And I think it was in 2018, I was teaching like 25, 30 classes a month and working full time. So I never want to go back to that. Like, I don't know how I did that. After the pandemic and being home, I don't understand how I did what I used to do. And I'm not going to fill my schedule like that. But there were times when I was like, you know, and when my son was younger, so he was born in 2009, my younger son, and then in 2013 I did teacher training, so I was trying to teach as many classes as I could and get up to par on that, and, you know, my job was pretty status quo at that point, so I was away from home a lot, and I definitely had those thoughts, yeah. But he's okay.
We call it, in my house, we call it guilt parenting. Mm. Like, there's just I think it's just our nature, right? Like, we have all of these standards that we want to meet as mothers, and especially in this architecture industry, it's just such a demanding career. Like, you're just always there feeling guilty, you know? When I was going to school and working full time, guilty I wasn't there and they were always with dad. When I was a single mom, just guilty because they were home a lot. You know, and then, you know, as time goes on, you're like, you just got to give yourself a break, right? Like, we as women just need to, like, cut it out. Just stop.
Right.
Like, we all are doing the best that we can, and we love our children, and having balance is this impossible thing, right?
Not
like,
right.
You're giving up, you got to give up stuff, right?
Right.
And, you know, if you have spouses, then it's trying to give them enough time, and where do you have time for yourself, and, like, just, we just need to stop.
Yeah.
Stop feeling guilty about not being enough, or whatever, like, sorry, people, I'm not going to spend time this long getting my hair done. These are my grays. Get over it.
On the flip side, I would clear my schedule and be home, and then they would all, like, not even know I was there. Because they'd stop doing their own thing, and I'd be like, okay, I'm going to go to yoga.
Do you guys have any advice for other mothers on how to handle that mentally, that guilt, that feeling like you're not enough to, because I feel like maybe that would spiral out at some point, and to feel, kick yourself out of that mentality.
Well, I mean, it's like with anything, I would say just take a step back. Just take a step back if you're feeling like in that spiral. Because, like I said, I've been there, but you just have to go, okay, no, my kid is pretty awesome. Like, start going with the gratitude route and thinking what is good and
advice.
I mean, that helps. And in the big picture, you're probably doing just fine.
Yeah.
Yeah. We're all a lot harder on ourselves.
And I think get off social media because everybody only posts their good stuff, and their perfect stuff. And I think sometimes that makes you feel like less than sometimes because you're seeing all these people doing all this great stuff. And I think we have a tendency to do the comparison game, and it makes us feel less than. And I know social media is like the worst for that. Yes, some people are going to have things better. People are going to have things worse. But I think just realizing that you're doing the best that you can, and nobody has a perfect life. And nobody's doing it perfectly. Even if it looks like they are, they're not.
Right. Comparison is the theft of joy. Yeah.
So
don't compare.
My husband, we get the holidays, so we get those letters. Mm-hmm. People talk about all their the wonderful
things. Oh, yeah, everything they did for the whole year.
Every year, my husband says, this is the year we are going to keep track of every screw up. Everything that went wrong. Everything that was a disaster. And we're going to send a letter out and that about everything we screwed up and how bad
that would be awesome.
But it would be juicy, it sure would be good.
Well, you like the help, right? Hearing other people and what they're going through, and if you're not alone, and hearing your story about the beginning of your daughter's book, I just did it a month ago. And I felt like an asshole, right? And the dread, they came over me and I got that phone call. I will never forget. So knowing that I've done it too.
Yeah.
I've done it
until I had actually the phone beat for me at a certain time all the way through this meeting until they started driving. Because I would get into a phone call, you'd get into an email or into a meeting, and you just kind of lost time, and then gotta go to this place, you know. So.
I had to start setting my alarm because I was doing that. If I didn't have my alarm to stop me, I would never, you know.
Maybe 6 months ago, or maybe not even that, I think I emailed something to my son, and I just, it happened to go out with my business email that I had on the website. And I get a call back going, oh, you actually did have a firm. I just thought you were leaving to get rid of us for a little while. I said, hey, you've done some stuff. It's like, it's, you know, it was a personal email, I was never a business, and I never looked it up, and it was like, it's just out there, and
so I did actually have a big mom failure moment. Probably about 5 years ago. I had gone back to work when he was 3 years old, and I went back to work, and I went back to work like I didn't have a kid, you know, and I had a big deadline, and I think I worked until midnight for a month straight, and he kind of took me aside, held my hand, and said, you know, Mommy, you're never around, and it just broke my heart. I was like, that is the moment that I changed things. You know, I did set the alarm. I left the office every day at 6 o'clock. It didn't matter if I had something open or not. It really, I mean, we're all saying it. It's all about priorities. You can do it. Like 10 years ago, I never thought, not in a million years, that I would ever be able to handle. Like, you know, just like Monica's saying, like, I don't know how you do it. And now looking back, I can't imagine my life without, you know, and yes, it's a little hectic and everything else, but it wouldn't be the same. It just wouldn't be the same. But, you know, there was definitely that moment that, you know, he just was like, you're not around. So it makes you think, and that mom guilt is real and it's hard.
Guys,
get around it.
I have a question.
I train my employees that I'm not going to be in before 9, and I train my clients that I will not be there after 6. So They all knew that after 6, they all chewed that. I didn't have a boss on it, which I think a lot of you guys have. But I think they need to realize, too, there's, and I try not to guilt my, you know, my clients try to guilt me into having my employees give up a weekend. And I said, you know, I can ask them if they want to, but if they don't want to, their job does not depend on it. So we'll get to it on Monday or Tuesday or whenever we have the time. So
that's tough too. The climate that we work in, Las Vegas, like you can work anywhere else in the world. If you've worked here, you can work anywhere else. Like the pace and the clients, everything's so demanding. To be able to actually draw that line and train, you know, train is a harsh word, but train your clients and you know, train your employers. That where your priorities lie, it's tough. It's very, like, not only is it tough for a woman in the industry, but this particular industry in Las Vegas, because hospitality or whoever it is you're designing for, they're the most important in their world, and that's what they expect out of you. And it's like, well, no.
Yeah, so for that, about hospitality, because there's way too much demand on that for everything to be done yesterday, basically. And training, I would, you know, maybe it's a harsh word, but I've had clients since 96 when I started, you know, I started my business in 94. That's the same repeat clients since 96. They remember me being pregnant with my son and my little daughter in tow, you know. So I think if you get the job done right for them, they'll keep coming back, you know, and they'll be able to, not everything you do yesterday. And I've had clients call me first thing, you know, they call on Friday afternoon, say, we need this done, and then they call first thing on Monday morning at 8, well, is it done? And I, you know, my direct question back, oh, hello, nice, you know, how was your weekend? Oh, it was great. How about yours? Great. What did you do? Oh, I did this with my family. I said, so did I. Nothing got done. We'll talk to you tomorrow morning. You just have to kind of, you know, I maybe it came with age after a while. It's like, you could say, you know what, you can leave. I don't, you know, there's another client knocking on the door at some point or another, so.
So, real quick, Nesreen, you still have your question?
Yes, I do. Hello, everybody. All right. I'm going to try not to make it too long, but I'm in an in-between phase right now, moving from Las Vegas to Seattle, and I have been spoiled rotten by Monica. So I was working with her for her, and when I was pregnant with my first child, and my son was basically in the office with me from the age of 3 months to 11 months until I was comfortable enough to take him to a Montessori. And Monica was still kindly let me, you know, I drop him off first, then I go to the office. And when I have to pick him up, I have to leave. If he's sick, I can go home. This one was a COVID baby, so we were at home anyway. She is going to be 8 months old in a few days, and we are moving to Seattle, and I'm applying for jobs, and I'm scared. I look at the descriptions of what they say. I'm sorry if I get a bit emotional. Just listening to all of you has made me realize how scared I am. Listen, reading all the work descriptions of what they expect, you know, of the different positions that I've been applying for. And it's made me sit down and wonder, you know, do I want to continue in an architecture firm? Really, I want to get licensed here in the US, and I'm doing it just for myself, not to start a firm or anything. It's just to prove to myself that I can call myself an architect. I have 3 exams to go in about 150 odd hours. And I'm sure Monica will not mind me doing remote work to finish those hours. So it's giving me the opportunity to think, okay, maybe I don't get into architecture, although I love it and would love to continue working on it. But it's scary. I'm so scared. I look at all these descriptions and I'm like, okay, how do I go in there in the interview and make sure they understand? I have a family. I have 2 kids who are less than 4. He will be 4 in October. And they need their time. I'm not going to be sitting down and doing 80 hours a week. I'm not going to be working until God knows what time at night. they have priority, but I still want to work. And it scares me, like, if I mention that, they'll be like, okay, goodbye. You know, and how do you find a firm where they'd be open to that, where there's flexibility, or how do you approach it? What do I say at an interview to make it sound like I really want to do this work, but I have a family? Or do I just give up on architecture and look it into other things? I don't know. I really don't know.
So how would employers look at that? That's what I want to know.
Sorry?
Well, I said, I'm asking, like, how do the employers look at that? Because two of you are employers.
Well, when I started my firm, being from all over the globe as a parent, you know, a single mom for 10 years with 3 kids with no father in their life. You know, my kids don't have a biological father that's in their life after, you know, so many years after the divorce. I started my firm with the intention to be a company that is, you know, supportive of women. And so we don't have PCs, we have laptops, so that if I have mothers that need to leave, they can work from home. If their kids are sick, they can work from home. And fathers too, to give my company the flexibility to be a place where we mentor young women to follow their dreams. I think you have to make decisions on what's best for you. Nobody can tell you what the best path for you is. For me, I didn't want to resent my kids because I couldn't follow my dreams. I couldn't imagine doing anything else in the whole world. So I was not going to give up on my career dreams and then resent the fact I couldn't do that because I had kids. So I felt like that's the way that I could be the best mom that I could be, was to pursue, no matter the cost, my profession that I wanted to be in. But I think you're interviewing the companies that you're working for as much as they're interviewing you, and you're going to find out if they have the culture where they support you as a woman and as a mother. And if they don't, they're probably not the best fit for you.
Okay. What I'm worried about is, okay, what if I go to, I don't know, 10 interviews and none of them are a fit?
Then go to 10 more.
Well, you're getting ahead of yourself. Go to one interview at a time.
I think it's part of the framing too, right? It's like, because just the way that you said it, you were like, I want to be in architecture, but I have a family. It's not like that. It's, I want to be an architect and I have a family. It's not, but it's not one or the other. You can do it all. You have to have that mindset, and it can be done.
It is hard, though. I mean, even though I had my in the office, while I was sitting there on my desk, if he started crying, I'm like, please let me just finish this one drawing, just one line, and then I will come and pick you up. And I always felt guilty. I felt guilty for him, and then if I went and picked him up, I felt guilty for whatever was on the computer waiting for me. And I guess it's going to be like that always, but yeah.
It's just not pretty. It's just not a pretty thing. You know, like, it's ugly. It's not ugly all the way through. It continues to be ugly. You know, to get very personal, I also have an 18-year-old girl that lived with me the last year because she comes from an abusive household and basically showed up at my doorstep, and I wasn't going to turn her away. And this probably was 6 months ago or something like that. I was in a client meeting, Zoom call, and I get a call from my daughter, and then I didn't answer it because I was in a meeting, and then I get a text saying, like, 911, you need to pick up. So I excused myself from the call. I went in the other room, and she said, look, I called the paramedics because this 18-year-old girl that's living with us tried to overdose, and I had to excuse myself embarrassedly from this meeting to say I had a family emergency. Things like that have happened throughout my career. And it's just not a pretty thing. You have to put your kids first, and if your employer doesn't understand, your client doesn't understand, then you just got to move on.
Okay. You just have to be honest up front during your interview process. I mean, like,
have children.
Yeah.
I mean, even if they're men, they have children. They may have wives at home taking care of them, or maybe they don't, but they both sort of take turns, I think most people will understand.
And you could ask the interviewer, how flexible are you in regards to, the time at work, or is there flexibility, because this is a very important ask that if they say, no, we're not flexible, at the end of the day, you don't want to work for this firm because they're not going to understand your needs the day of the interview and most likely during your tenure and employment with them.
You agree?
And then you're going to end up taking it out on your children. You're going to be in a bad mood every day. Then they're going to grow up hating, like, I don't know, my mom is crazy, and get into trouble as they get older. Yeah.
It's funny that you said that men are parents too. Men are parents too, because when I was checking out the firms, the first thing I do is go check team. And who's in it? How many females are there? And a lot of them were, of course, dominantly men that were working in the firms. There's one or two that I found only men in.
Probably not the one you want to go for.
Oh, women in leadership. Look for when I was looking at firms. Do they have women in leadership?
Great advice.
And maybe if they're younger as well, because, well, I don't know. Right?
Thanks for looking at me.
You have the same, except I don't have any kids. But I was thinking about, because I just, when I said it, I was thinking, well, maybe that's not fair, because it depends on, like, how you came up, right? So I'm wondering now, like, if you're younger and you have kids, does that make you look at hiring women who have kids? Does that make you look differently at them? Or if you are older and you've had kids, does that make you look at younger women with kids differently? I don't know.
Well, coming from someone that started having kids late, I had my daughter at 40, my son at 42. I'm going to be 47 this year. I think it's just how much you carry yourself, how honest you are. Age or whatever shouldn't really matter if the employer is serious about that potential candidate. You know, to me, being a young mom or being an older mom shouldn't really matter.
Honestly, listening to all your stories as an employer, you're pretty badass. Mm-hmm. And just knowing that you can handle all of those things would make me absolutely want you on my team, because even after your kids get older and then I get you all to myself. But I mean, I can't imagine like thinking that it would be detrimental to hire a woman who is of childbearing age for that reason, because I don't know, you guys just
seem it's to all in here.
Nail it.
It's not a matter of age. It's all up here.
As an employee, I would say it doesn't matter your mother, it doesn't matter if you're a 15 player, it matters your work ethic, that's all that any employer is going to want, and if you're willing to and able to provide that while at the same time demanding your own time for your family and able to juggle both, it will not matter. So at the end of the day, an employer wants production. That's what they hired you for. So if you find a way to give them that and then take what you need, that's all that matters.
Honestly, if you just up front at the beginning and let me know what it is, then I can, I mean, we're all good at scheduling, right? We have to, and we're juggling projects that are 100 puzzle pieces and we've got 20 of them. We've got to be able to juggle time and stuff. So if I know up front that these are your terms, I feel like it shouldn't be an issue, right? Because then I can find other people in the firm to kind of come in and help alleviate some of the stress if you have to go pick up your kid because they're sick or something like that. It's just, I think it's just honesty and openness to your employers will help you so much right from the beginning, because then if they don't want to hire you for that reason, well, then it's not the right place to work in the first place.
As an employer, and there's 13 of us in our office now, we've tried to create a culture where it doesn't matter if you're a man or a woman, if you're young or old, and create a culture of as much flexibility as possible. So if someone with a child needs to take an afternoon off because they want to see their child play baseball, that's cool. But at the same time, if someone else in the office, and maybe, you know, they may or may not have kids, it doesn't matter. None of these things matter. If they need the time, they need the time, right? They need to take their dog to the vet. Great, you go do that. We've created a culture, we continue, it's an ongoing process. and we're always trying to evolve and do better, but create a culture where everybody can have that level of flexibility. And then it becomes very fair across the board, because I've been in situations where there's been someone with a child, and they needed to take the time, and someone else in the office then has to come and pick up the ball, right? And they feel like, hey, I'm always picking up the ball for that person, right? Well, then you have to be able to give that person that same level of flexibility for whatever reason when they need it. Mm-hmm. And so we work really hard in our office that it doesn't matter if you're a man or a woman, it doesn't matter how old you are, it doesn't matter how many kids you are, if you don't have any kids, taking your dog to the vet is as important as you taking going to see your kids play baseball or going to the orthodontist or, you know, whatever it is. And that, you know, talking about being team players, right, that helps create that, I think, that culture of being a team player. Mm-hmm. Yes, I will do that so you can go do that. And next week, I have to do this. Can you handle this meeting for me? Right? And empowering people to be able to make those decisions themselves. And hiring the kind of staff that you can empower that way. And so to what she's saying, we have someone who works in Michigan. Licensed landscape architect, kids at home. She works from home. She is one of our most productive employees. It's incredible. She's never set foot in our office. And she found out. So, you know, don't give up and keep looking. And, yeah, 10 more interviews if you need to. And use your connection, right? She found us because she knew somebody who had worked with someone in our office and just cold called us. So, don't leave any rock unturned.
Okay, will do. Thank you, everybody.
She is pretty adorable.
So do you think some of the perception might be part of the problem that we've kind of built up over time with history of, you know, male-dominated mm-hmm. industry, that we're still kind of maybe part of the problem is we're our own worst enemy. We build it up in our head that they're not going to accept this from us. They're not going to be flexible. My clients are not going to give me any leeway. Is there any of that might be just perception rather than reality? I know a lot of my clients seem pretty lax about stuff. If I just come forward and say, listen, we're overwhelmed. I lost somebody. I brought somebody on. We're training, and now it's going to be 3 more days. Is that cool? They're usually like, yeah. which I, when I started my firm, would have never expected, honestly. I think I've built up a lot of that fear, maybe. Maybe that's not the right
it's
word
like kind of
in my
head.
That
I agree with that. I don't know.
Is there any advice on how to deal with that?
You know, working in architecture and construction, you know, yes, we do have the preconceived notion that it could still be a male-dominated field. And, you know, maybe some women may try to overcompensate their aura by being, like, really in their face or, you know, whatever. But I think at the end of the day, if you just hold yourself accountable, you know, and have the backup information to back your statement, and just remain professional, I've had no issues with males of any age looking down on me saying, oh, you're a woman or a minority. I don't let that get to my head because you yourself know the knowledge that you have up here and experience to back yourself up when dealing with men or dealing with situations of that nature.
We always have to be the best prepared person at the table.
And just keep a, you know, a very neutral face.
I think to your point on honesty is, when you're honest and just lay things out, you set the expectation. Okay? Then everybody is on the same page, and then we eliminate or reduce disappointments and miscommunications. And I mean, going back to your interview the person that's hiring you. I hired somebody with a lot of medical conditions, and she was my office manager. And she told me that in the beginning, like, I'm going to have a lot of doctor's appointments. And she was fantastic. I mean, she was gone when she needed to, but she was there early and stayed late and took care of things. And I didn't want to find that out later on, though.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean? I got to leave again. What's going on? You know, she told me, and then we knew, and it worked out. So I think just setting expectations and saying what, you know, demanding what you want, which is to be an architect and a mom, not one or the other.
Well, and I think it goes back to that comparison thing, too, is instead of comparing ourselves to the men, we need to realize that we are not men, and we are different, and we innately do things different, and embrace our good qualities instead of trying to compare ourselves to the men that are out there as well. And I think that's what we get. I think it's, again, that comparison game. So we're in a male-dominated business. I've not really had any problems, you know, with the men that I've worked with. Most of them have been extremely gracious. But it's in, you know, it was always in my head that, well, I've got to be like this because that's what is around me, instead of embracing my unique talents as a woman. And so, you know, my thing again is that comparison. And it is like the little evil out there, I think, in our brains is trying to compare and be something that we're not, and instead of embracing who we are.
If I could add to that too, I think that it is a perception, Anna, because when you really think about it over the years, like it used to be that women 100% were the caregivers. Now it's 68%. Yes, it's still heavy, but you got to realize that there's 32% of men out there that are the caregivers, that understand the same struggles that we're going through. So, I mean, it is a perception, and, you know, instead of being, just be a part of the solution and understand that everybody has in their life and the way that they see things. And I think that you can get through it. I'm optimistic to a fault, I guess.
Yeah, throw out your projections, right?
I mean, exactly.
We're so used to it being a certain way, but it really isn't. And things, especially with the last year, with the way the workforce has changed and everybody, I mean, it should never go back to what it was. And it looks like a lot of us are on that track already, you know.
I would say I'm definitely my own worst enemy, you know, because I have in my head that I need to be the smartest, the most prepared, the hardest working, you know, to just be at the same playing field in our industry. So I put that pressure on myself, right?
That's what makes us better.
I never stopped working. If I'm in front of the TV, I'm looking at design, so I can study the design, like every aspect of it, right? So I'm putting this pressure on myself. And I've been where I was the breadwinner with a husband who is a stay-at-home dad. I've been the only provider, and now I share 50-50 responsibility. And my husband's a complete angel because he didn't have his own kids, so he's been raising my crazy kids with me for the last 5 years. And he's the one that really shook me and put things into perspective and was like, look, your 13-year-old has in his phone the name for you as work too hard. Like, and that was a big wake-up call for me. It was like, okay, like you just have to have more balance than you've just got to balance it out a little bit. And by the way, like the spouse maybe wants some time in there too, right?
Yeah.
And I'm like, oh yeah, like I have a loving husband at home who would like to see me, right? So I think we're our own worst enemy. We put a lot of pressure on ourselves as women to, like, you know.
So you see the deck being stacked against us, but it's like,
absolutely.
You talk about deadlines and how clients
maybe going towards deadlines, and I actually have a hard time not meeting the deadline. So you're right, I do that for myself. I do it myself.
Yeah.
I take pride in meeting that deadline. I have to meet it.
And
maybe it's not a big deal, but we do it to ourselves.
Absolutely.
Something
about that record, right?
Never miss one.
But some of it is just the asking, and that could be the hardest part too, because you build it up in your head that they're going to say no, they're going to be mad, they're going to be pissed, they'll never hire me again. And then you talk to them, and they're like, oh, yeah, it's fine. You know, I wasn't going to look at it for another week anyway.
Right.
You know,
what?
Why would you say, like, even the thing? But,
or maybe we need to ask for help, and we're too prideful to,
exactly,
like, ask people to join the team and help us get it done.
I mean, we have so many resources in this room just now, like, just advice. We could ask each other these things, like, what did you do for this?
Being very specific in our proposals, and Anna, you will understand, this is landscape architects, we are usually the last piece of the puzzle, right? We have to wait for everybody to get their work done, and then we'll get the base plan, right? And we'll get the updates at the end, but we all still have the same deadline.
Yeah.
So what we started, and it varies from project to project, because every project is different and every size of project is different. But now, at every task, right, whether it's a schematic, DD, whatever it is, we'll put in there, we need, you know, a minimum of 2 days, a minimum of 10 days, working days, from the time we get the file to when we can do, we can deliver. And so people see this and they sign it. And I have never once had to call a client on it and say, well, no, our contract says we have, you know, 5 days, and so, you know, you're not going to get this tomorrow. Not once. I mean, so many times we'll call and say, hey, I know we're supposed to give you 5 days, but can you get it done in 2 or 3?
Mm-hmm.
Right?
It's about being upfront with the whole process.
Yeah, and so now we actually have it in there. And it's actually, it works, and people appreciate it because we set those boundaries and we set those parameters. And we're not waiting for it to hit.
Part of that is on the way that you run things, and if you've got there's been other firms that I've worked for where they wouldn't even consider that sort of putting that back onto the client. So it's just shit rolls downhill to the employees of said firm, and it's great to hear that you've created that within Leish.
Yeah, we put it on every. And now, certain repeat clients that we do a lot of work with, right? They, you know, they know it's coming. They understand that, and so it's not. We have not gotten any pushback on it. Yeah.
I've had, I think, maybe only a couple of clients over the years where they try to get me on the delay clause. You know, you'll pay this much, but I'm like, yeah, no. I am not spending my whole time on this project covering my ass, literally. It's not going to happen. There's so many people that can be late on something that's going to affect your deadline, that it's too much time just trying to cover yourself at that point. So, yeah, have a good life. See you later.
Yeah, it's kind of choices, right?
Yeah.
We all have to make choices on what clients we work with, on what takes priority.
Because something like that just really put some stress on you if you're looking at it. I mean, it's not like they're making a ton of money on any of that stuff anyway. So if you put $50 a day for every day that you're late, you know, your contract's going to get done like that.
Yeah.
And it won't even be your fault. It's because it might be his fault for not giving you a certain answer, you know. But all you're doing at that point is trying to figure out whose fault it is. All
And that's not a very good team mentality.
So conversations and communication. Just like when you're going after a new job without me. Just saying. Ted.
Still there. Those are Monica's out there, right?
What?
Those are Monica's out there?
No. No.
Speaking of juggling, I have to get home to my daughter.
So great.
Thank you so
good
much.
Good to see you. So when we were coming over, Lisa said, yes, we have, you know, we have mom scheduled. So we were thinking, yeah, well, we may have a shorter meeting than we usually have because we have a whole bunch of moms attend this one.
This meeting was really great, though. I mean,
it was.
I'm not a mom, but I loved hearing the story.
Yeah.
And I would like to invite everybody to come back for the happy hour that we're going to, I think we have one scheduled for July. Is that our second
is
happy
hour? Is
that
what it is?
Okay,
if
so happy hour
back,
next
month,
we can.
You drinkers.
We'll send out an email to the whole group.
In person. We're in person now.
I feel like there's a lot of stories that could still be shared on and advice that could be thrown around
for days.
Some days I'm just like, oh God, I feel like I'm 150 years old. I'm so tired, you know, like, and I don't drink, so I'm like, what do I do is just stay awake? Or
that's why you have to drive. And it's just like a blur. It's like work home. Yeah.
And it's like before kids,
pre-pandemic
kids, I was a gym rat. So now we're all like, me and my husband just blot home and we're just like, Oh, so it's like,
you have dog fur in the corners.
My dog's not shut.
Yeah, whatever.
We've got about 10 minutes left, but if we want to close it up early, we can. Any other questions from anybody in the virtual coming to us from the interwebs?
What age do they come and become independent?
35.
I'm still 35.
My 50-year-old brother lives at home, so, you know.
19-year-old.
Could be an awful thing.
Right. Failure to launch.
Yeah.
I didn't hear anybody say an age.
So, my son is 12, and I have to be two brains, mine and his. So.
I'm at 15 months, Kelly. We're at 15 months, and I don't,
It's boy or girl.
It's a lot harder than I remember it being.
Is it a boy or a girl?
A boy.
Round five. I'll say round five.
Five.
Yeah, five.
Yep, but I miss my kids. I miss my kids at that age, you know, from like 18 months to 2 years. They're like,
I
cute. Even now.
No. 6 months to 1 year. It's really cute.
Yeah, I miss that age. Like,
they still smell good.
Right?
I know, right?
So enjoy it, but actually, I still don't have any good news for you with the boy.
Like I'm incapacitated or over 15. No.
Robert's already mad at me because he had to take Alex to daycare and pick him up today. So. No, thank you all for this very insightful meeting. It was good to hear that I'm not alone in my struggles.
You're not.
I'm a newish. I'm a newish mom. So it was
you know, one of the things that I wish, especially employers, like one of the things that I think that should really be considered is a childcare benefit. And that way that would be something, especially for single parents, you know, that would take a lot of the guilt and the pressure off, you know, that like, you know, when my son was in daycare, it was $1,000 of like whatever it was a month. And it was like, why am I even working at that point? And, you know, you know, so I'll just stay home and take care of them instead of this. But I think that would be an awesome thing if we could, I don't know, petition for childcare services. And I think that would be a really great opportunity for, you know, employers to say that they understand and embrace, you know, to say that they offer this, like, I don't know, it could be something as minimal as like a $50 stipend, but like to just say, hey, we hear you, you know.
Yeah,
I don't know.
I like that, Michelle.
All right.
Everybody,
thank
for
you.
Coming.
Thank you.
Our next meeting is on. Shoot, I just
got
it. Building your professional network.
Okay.
So we'll be talking about that.
And that is July 20th. I think that's the 20th of July. Yeah. You concur?
No,
27. Kelly said it's the 27th. So we'll see you guys on the 27th. Thanks for coming.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Don't be so cute, Ashley.